I have to summarize the results in three major bullets. First of all, regarding skeletal-related events, because we talk about bone disease in multiple myeloma. So the study was designed to have as a primary endpoint the non-inferiority of denosumab versus hyaluronic acid, and this primary endpoint was met in this study. However, because we've seen that during the first 3 months of therapy we had the majority of the skeletal-related events, we wanted to see what's going to happen after 1 year of these 3 months where we had the majority of the skeletal-related events, in order to see if the prolongation of the administration of denosumab created any difference compared to zoledronic acid. And as I'm going to present in this meeting, we found very interestingly that the time to the first skeletal-related event was much prolonged with denosumab compared to zoledronic acid, so this was a statistically significant difference. And also we have seen that the different types of skeletal-related events, we had a reduction to the time of this first skeletal-related event with denosumab compared to the zoledronic acid. So I think that denosumab, which is considered a more potent osteoclast inhibitor compared to zoledronic acid, also after this period, this landmark analysis, the 15-month landmark analysis, showed that it can reduce the time to the first skeletal-related event. Second is safety. And the major safety signal that we are interested in is the renal safety profile of a drug, because patients with multiple myeloma have renal impairment at a proportion of more than 20%. 20% at diagnosis, and as the time of the disease passes, we see larger incidence of renal impairment. So this is something important. And we do know that the monoclonal antibody are not clears, like denosumab, are not clear through the kidneys. So we wanted to see if there was going to be any differences, because we do know also that zoledronic acid produces renal problems in approximately 10 to 20% of patients. So this was another important issue. And also we wanted to check hypocalcemia that both drugs can create, and also osteonecrosis of the jaw, which is an important issue for patients with multiple myeloma. So regarding renal problems, we've seen that patients with who received denosumab had only 10% renal problems with denosumab, compared to 17% of zoledronic acid. But if we see patients with creatinine clearance between 30 and 60, meaning renal impairment patients, then you can see that denosumab produces 13% of renal problems versus 26% denosumab produced 13% of renal problems compared to 26% of Zometa. So you can see that we have twofold lower incidence of renal problems with denosumab compared to zoledronic acid. Regarding hypocalcemia, denosumab is a more potent agent, so we had a slightly increased number of hypocalcemia patients compared to zoledronic acid, and also we had more osteonecrosis of the jaw, but this was not of statistically significant. The third important point is the progression-free survival. Although it was an exploratory endpoint in this study, we've seen that patients who received denosumab had between 10 and 11 months of progression-free survival advantage. And I think that this is extremely important. I can understand from the statistical point of view that the exploratory endpoint is exploratory endpoint, it's not the primary, secondary point of the study. But of course, on the other hand, 10 months of PFS advantage is something very important. And possibly this also is due to the potency of denosumab, because we do know that the osteoclasts contribute to the myeloma cell survival and growth. Probably with a more potent osteoclast inhibitor, you can also contribute to the better progression-free survival of the patients. Of course, this has to be confirmed in a study where the primary endpoint has to be the PFS, but at least the first results are very promising.